Let's pray. God of life, send your Holy Spirit to guide us as we listen to your stories from Scripture that may sound familiar or unfamiliar. Speak your truth in ways that opens our minds and our hearts to a deeper understanding of your living word. Amen. I don't know that I've ever heard a sermon on Psalm 137, and Catherine kind of paused near the end, right? It's to see the choir was like, whoa. It recalls the lament of a people. It recalls the time when their land has been overcome by a violent invader. They sit by the Babylon and they weep. They're angry. And they carry their anger to God. And then they make one of the most shocking statements in Scripture. Blessed shall he be who takes your little ones and dashes them against the rock. It's reasonably shocking sentiment, I think. Most of us have not gotten there in our lives. I don't know if all of you have read the whole Psalter before and know that that's even tucked away in the middle of your Bible. One thing to say about it is that it opens up possibilities for prayer. If you pray with something close to hatred in your heart, if you are at the point where you would pray that somebody else's infant wouldn't make it, then you're not the first person to pray that. And what the psalm is teaching us is that God can handle hearing that kind of prayer. I'm not saying we want to get there, or that we want to wish anybody to be in these kind of circumstances, but that sometimes we might feel these things. Generally, we probably feel shame and discomfort about those feelings. Other times, we will remain white hot and angry for a long, long while. We might hold that kind of prayer and at exactly the same time feel holy and righteous. And the Bible is showing us we're not alone in this. You can write a psalm while simultaneously thinking you can bless those who are going to bash a baby against a rock. It recognizes the reality that the world is a broken place. It is full of injustices, large and small, and people get angry. From wars to domestic violences, from abuse to working people who have to line up for food in a land of plenty, it is very easy to get angry. It's also easy to get angry because we ourselves are broken people. We are imperfect, we are not always fair, and we are sure not always right. We often hurt each other, sometimes on purpose, sometimes not on purpose, and yet we manage to do it anyways. Sin makes the world go round, and point our fingers at one another, we will. It's the first Sunday in Lent, and there's been a lot of finger pointing in our world. And in Lent, we do well to try to take a communal breath, a big breath. We enter into tried and true practices, historic practices that work in good years and in bad. Practices meant to bring us back to center and back to God. And then we are enabled to go back out into the world and engage with it again. In Lent, it's common to fast, to pray, and to give generously. In Lent, you celebrate simple living, we celebrate non-harm, and we celebrate self-denial. Lent, depending how you count it, is 40 days-ish. There's variations for a variety of reasons. And it's tied to the 40 days Jesus spends in the wilderness, engaging himself in prayer, in fasting, in self-denial for 40 days before he goes out into the world and starts really doing his ministry. When the devil tempts him in the story, you have to notice that it's part of this biblical pattern that God permits a person to be tempted. It happens over and over again in Scripture. Not to reveal God's inability to protect the character from bad things that happen, but in order to reveal the character's character in the story. Now, we like some of the elements of these. We like the idea of evil being an outside person or force that is imposed on the world and imposed on us. Like in movies, you love to have the clear bad guy or villain, and we like to have the clear good guy, superhero, whatever you want. We like to think evil is out there. It's in those types of people, in those types of places. It's comforting to think that because it creates a distance between me and the deplorable, right? It's outside of me. And sometimes we get good enough at making it outside of us that we will pray for the children's heads to be smashed in. And hopefully when we make a prayer like that, it gives us pause. Many read this passage of Jesus being tempted exactly this way. There's a villain, there's a hero, it's all clear, it's tied up with a nice bow at the end, it's easy reading. When evil is incarnated, it gets distanced, and thus we can attack it from our earliest days. Most of us are capable of this. We yell, it's not fair. Because from a very early age, we have a sense of justice, of right and wrong. And conveniently, we pretty much always find ourselves on the right side and others on the wrong side. I think that's part of why we like the story, and it's part of why a temptation story barely even impacts us, because most of the time we identify with the hero and we move on exactly as we already were. And of course, Jesus is a hero and he avoids temptation. He lives this perfect life and he manages to make people so angry with him while he does it that they string him up on a cross. They use their most grisly techniques to kill him so that through his death we are saved, and it's his perfection that leads to his death. Isn't that ironic? One of the fascinating elements of the biblical tale is that matters are almost never so black and white. Think of David, the one that is beloved of God, and his track record. The story of temptations of Jesus is the story of the attempt to bring out the worst in humanity. The devil in the story knows people well. He knows the buttons to push, and he tries them one after another. From the simplest and most basic to the most prominent, he will push the buttons until he gets the response he's looking for. It doesn't work on Jesus, but it mostly works on us. And in Lent, we take time to recognize this truth. We see it playing out. We see it playing out internationally with destructive wars. We see it playing out where famines arise because of an inability to distribute food fairly. We see it playing out when chaos pops up, and we see it happen in our own hearts and minds when we're up in the middle of the night worrying about whatever it is you worry about in the middle of the night. Before we walk straight through the story, though, I want to take one moment to recognize how the story is actually built. Just before this story, Jesus is baptized. And I think that's important. Some people seem to think that once you're baptized, everything's going to be awesome from here on forward, and it's only a matter of time before we're all driving Land Rovers. My personal jet is still under construction. It's not quite ready yet. It's like you're baptized, and then there's this transformation, this sanctification, this making of us that makes us holy so that we are right, and then everything we do is right. And every time we get angry, we are on God's side in our anger. And Jesus himself, he experiences something very different than that. He's baptized and then off to the wilderness without food. Now, we got to remember this, because some people think if you do something like, say, the sinner's prayer, it's over. And yet, the challenge remains. No matter how many times you've given yourself to God, the challenge remains, do we really trust God or not? Will we be tempted? Over and over again, the question, is God God or am I? Eve in the garden story is tempted to play God, right? And like Eve, it's disastrous when any of us give in and do it. And it's interesting that even Jesus, who was God, doesn't play God in the story. He's tempted to. Like you might remember there's this time where there's a woman and she's in trouble and they want to throw rocks at her, right, so that she'll die. And she's guilty. Everybody agrees she's guilty, right? She agrees she's guilty. And Jesus says, look, whoever's sinless, they can throw the first stone. Nobody throws the first stone, including Jesus, who is sinless and thus allowed to throw the stone with righteousness. He puts the stone down and he's surprised. He chooses forgiveness instead. The other thing to notice here is what wilderness means before we get too far. When you think of wilderness, I don't know what you think. Some of us think Gatineau Park. Maybe Algonquin Park if you want to be real wild. We think of recreation facilities away from houses and cars, generally speaking. That's what wilderness means, right? In the Bible, wilderness is a place of really serious struggle. Really serious danger. This is not a vacation. Jesus hasn't spent 40 days at a spa in the woods getting massages, eating vegan food, and drinking smoothies before his morning yoga sessions. That's not the wilderness Jesus spends his time in. The point is to recognize that because Jesus, when he encounters the devil in this story, is at his weakest. He is at his most vulnerable. That's the purpose of putting him there. He's baptized, then he's fasted, and now he's weak and tired. And I don't know about you, but when I'm weak and tired and I face temptation, I turn on Netflix and I eat chips and I get chocolate, and that's what I do. It's easy to fight temptation. It's easy to have willpower when we have energy, when everything's going well in life. When we are tired, temptations get a lot more powerful. And so the story takes place right when Jesus might think he's earned himself a treat. Right when he says, I deserve a break. I know none of you do this to yourselves, it's just me. But that's where Jesus and I are in the story. We need a break. 40 days without food, I can't imagine this. Facing death clearly, being dangled over some cliff top. It's not my story. Being offered all the power in the world, also not my story. But the scenarios, while not likely to happen to us, teach us about ourselves. We watch this scene unfold, right? Pride, vanity, greed, gluttony, they're all familiar temptations. There's this woman, Marietta Anschutz, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. She put it this way, it's pretty good. She says, temptation comes to us in moments when we look at others and feel insecure about not having enough. Temptation comes in judgments we make about strangers or friends who make choices we do not understand. Temptation rules us, making us able to look away from those in need and to live our lives unaffected by poverty, hunger, or disease. Temptation rages in moments when we allow our temper to define our lives, or when addiction to wealth, power, influence over others, vanity, or an inordinate need for control defines who we are. Temptation wins when we engage in the justification of little lies, small sins, a racist joke, a questionable business practice for the greater good, a criticism of a spouse or partner when he or she is not around. Temptation wins when we get so caught up in the trappings of life that we lose sight of life itself. These are the faceless moments of evil that, while mundane, lurk in the recesses of our lives and our souls. Lenten penitence engages the dark places in our lives that we may come face to face with them, name them, understand them, and seek forgiveness for them. It's not about guilt, it's about freedom from control. The control of our fears and insecurities that they have over us, and an amendment of life for a new beginning. In the story, Jesus is hungry, he's fasted, and he's offered food, and he turns it down. Greed or gluttony is in sight here. The line between how much money we need and how much money we have is a real slippery one. The horizon of more, it's always just over the hillside, right? Ask anybody and they want to make 10% more than they already do. Just a little bit more. But do we share the wealth? Do we ever pay for groceries for someone that looks like they could really use some groceries paid for today? Imagine what this neighborhood would look like if people who needed groceries and are, you know, couponing and doing every price matching thing conceivable, and you actually paid for their groceries for them, the relief they might feel. Or the person driving some real beat up car that has no business being out in this snow, and they're at the gas station and they're stopping at 10 bucks in the gas, and you fill it up for them. It's a different form of temptation. The second temptation has to do, I think, with recklessness, needless risk-taking. From crypto to refusing to wear masks in the middle of a pandemic, not listening to our doctors so that when we get a new knee, we don't bother to do the exercises and then find ourselves hobbling around a year later. Needless recklessness. Imagine what we can do if we actually try to stay healthy enough to fight the good fight, if we maintain our health so we can put our health to wise use in the world. God has given us, we're individuals and we're a community, the ability to do a lot of good. And that'd be good for our souls, but first we have to get over reckless living. Another way is to read this part of the story is that Jesus is tempted to save himself from danger. This is the critical one. He doesn't do it. And then he will walk away and he will tell his students, his disciples, people who would follow him, to take up their cross, not defend themselves. As he gets ready for the final night, his buddies, they get swords together and he's like, you don't need this. One or two is fine. Then he tells them to put their swords away. Pick up your cross. And the final temptation, this political, worldly power temptation. And this one might be really obvious. I mean, we can make the link, right? There's like a straight line to Putin here and aggression. What could be more human than to think, I know what's right, and if everybody just did what I think is right, the world would be better. Put up your hand if you've ever thought that. None of you, eh? Right. I'll tell you, I know nothing about public transit, but if they would put me in charge of OC Transpo, the city would be more livable. It's a very small step from that thought to seeking power for the wrong reasons. The problem, of course, is we all think we have the answers, and then we get out, and turns out not everybody agrees with our answers, and then we're confused. This is where we are called to submit to God's will. And so in the story, even Jesus turns down the political power. It could be more subtle than that, though. Most of us aren't going to face this kind of ability to just take over the world. But I was thinking about how we influence each other. We seek power through the way we influence each other. Not all of you do this, but you might have a perfect life on Instagram or a perfect life on Facebook or wherever. What if we did things without worrying who got credit instead of that? Mary's dad, he would be embarrassed if he knew I was saying this, I think, but he can't stand the staff room at the hospital because it gets dirty all the time. And so he just cleans it. Like all the doctors, they share like a microwave, right? And you know where that goes. The microwave becomes just absolutely outrageous. And so he will stop and he will clean the microwave and he will keep moving. And he's not looking to get credit. He's just trying to have a clean place to cook his lunch, right? What if instead of always trying to be right, always have everybody point to how good we are, the political thoughts we have that are correct and all of this, if we just tried to leave the world a little bit better than we found it? There's so many temptations for us to face. I'm sure you have other ones. During Lent, we reflect on what actually tempts us. What does all the temptation do to the way we treat the world and one another And what's it doing to our souls? Try to lay aside the temptations for a while. We all have something to work on, something that we know we can be doing better. Many people will try. One element of Lent has always been mourning, sadness, repentance, the admission of where we've been going wrong. Jesus avoids the three temptations in the story. He's faced them, he's conquered them, but we and the church, we have often failed in the face of temptation. In Lent, we take time to admit it. It's not to say that we're worms and we're terrible, but it's trying to be honest, truthful about who we want to be and who we believe God calls us to be. We live in grace, the grace of Christ, right? And we know we're forgiven. You have the baptism. But we can still recognize where we fail, where we let hatred burn inside of us, when we let jealousy control us, when we let lust guide our eyes or minds and we want to do better. When Jesus is tempted here, he responds with scripture. He's reliant on God to come through the temptations. A guy named Robert Bryan says, whatever form temptations may take, it may be passed through by the means of trust in God to provide what is needed. The tester's power is real, but it's limited. Like Jesus, believers can trust in God's word and saving power. Victory belongs to those who will follow Jesus' pattern. But this is the worst, this is the hardest part. If you don't remember anything from this sermon, try to remember this bit. This is a guy, Patrick Wilson. He noticed this, and I just think this is absolutely like core in 2023. The temptations are about Jesus, not about us. In this respect, our frustration replicates the aggravation that the tempter devil Satan knew in ever ascending heights. Jesus refuses to be who we want him to be. The devil wants him to take up any of the three, right? It's a battle of the wits for power. He wants Jesus to give in, and Jesus won't. He will not turn our stones into bread. You ever prayed for hungry people and not seen them fed? You ever prayed for someone sick and not seen them get better? Jesus turning down the temptation. He will not prove he is God to us, not that way. He refuses applause. This Patrick guy says he remains maddeningly himself. I don't know what you make of that. I know a lot of people want God and they want Jesus to be like a magical gumball machine in the sky. Put in your quarter and get out whatever you asked for. And he just won't do it. It's humbling to remember that Jesus is Jesus. He is obedient to God the Father, not to us, not to me. Especially when we are at our worst and most frustrated. When we want to see God act more than anything, when we want to see bread in the world, justice for the oppressed, the general revelation of God to be a reality seen by everybody. Crickets. Over and over and over again. The older you are, the more you know this is true. But we shouldn't be surprised by it. We're going to end with this. You pray this every week. Thy will be done means not my will be done. Right? Thy kingdom come means I'm not the king. You pray it every week. And yet it's awful hard to let it sink in. And so we'll end the sermon this week by praying that prayer. And I invite you to pay attention here to the ways you're not in control in this. The way is, it's a prayer of submitting to God's authority, whatever that looks like. And remembering that more often than not, it's not going to look like we want. But one day it'll look like it has to. I invite you to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.